All right. As Alice Cooper once said, welcome to my nightmare. We made it 5 years, and then the sewer line, you know, old cast iron thing just snapped. Happened Friday night, I think.
After service.
After service, yeah. Didn't happen before because I remember using it. I was using the urinal. I used the urinal and it flushed before the service. So I knew it happened after. The benefits of having a master's degree. I don't really know what we're staring at here. It could be a couple more weeks before the place is fixed. So we're just kind of playing it by ear. Amen. But anyway, in spite of the construction, this is my favorite service of the week, because of the month, I should say, because I get to take interesting questions and answers. So let's start off by going through the basics again. I haven't done this for a couple months. According to the Bible, every person is built the same way. They're all made out of five parts, and they all have five senses. Everybody's built the same. These are your five parts, and your five senses are hearing. Everything in your life, from the time you're born to the time you drop dead, comes in through your five senses. Hearing, smelling, tasting. It's processed in the mind and stored in the brain. So for example, in first grade, 2 + 2 = 4. I see the teacher, I hear the problem. It's processed in my mind and stored in my brain. Now I don't need a teacher. I got it. Normal human learning. Everybody learns the same. Unfortunately, childhood trauma is not processed like that in the body. The trauma occurs out here, molestation, beatings, muggings, abandonment. And what happened is processed in your mind. The memory of it is stored in your brain, but the pain of it is stored here in your soul. Your soul is the seat of your emotions. Your conscience is the seat of your morality. Your spirit man is the seat of your spirituality. Your mind is the seat of your intelligence and your IQ. You are born with an IQ, and you cannot change it. So if you were born an idiot, you'll die an idiot. If you were born Elon Musk, you die brilliant. You can train your mind to improve how your brain works, for example, memory techniques and word association, blah, 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 but you cannot change your IQ from being an idiot to a NASA scientist. No matter how much training or education you get, a dumb person will never end up at NASA. Hello? Same with your race. Sorry about this. Same with your sex. You're born with these genetics, and they cannot be changed. Yeah. So Elon Musk's IQ is way up here. Mine is way down here. There's nothing I can do to go here any more than I could become black. I can't do it. I cannot become a female. This is what you're born with. This is who you are. Some people are born with more sensitive souls, and therefore they are more emotional than other people. Generally speaking, women tend to have more sensitive souls than men. Generally speaking, women tend to kind of feel emotionally more than men do. Generally speaking, there's obvious exceptions. People can be born with a sensitive spirit. Okay? As you know, that's a child who, without any training or teaching, already knows there's something in the spirit world. Some kids have an innate sense God exists. Most kids do not have nothing. Five senses, that's it. If I can't smell it or taste it, that's all I know. Not these kids. They know something's out there. They don't know what it is, but they know it's there. When you're in the womb, the Holy Spirit and demons targeted you. Everybody knew what you were like before you were born, because you're in here. Those with sensitive spirits get a bullseye on their back, because if this kid gets to the Holy Ghost before the demons get him, they become some kind of a great superstar for God. John Lake, Sister Etter, and so on. So the demons make absolutely sure that that person has no chance of finding God. And the way they fishhook them is they start bringing them spiritual things, which by nature is, they will instantly go to something spiritual. Friends, teachers, whatever. New age, witchcraft, sorcery, spiritual stuff, anything. Because the kid naturally goes there. Some people, as you know, are born with great bodies. See? And I'm enjoying all those benefits. And you've got some people like Michael Jordan who were dunking outside the womb. A hand came out of the womb and was looking for... That's genetic. Some people can't chew gum and walk if you held a shotgun in their head. You cannot take a person who's physically retarded and turn them into Wilt Chamberlain. It's not possible. You cannot do it. Okay? So, the curb is your genetics, and you never get out of that curb. When you become a born-again Christian, the Holy Spirit enters your spirit man here, and you become born again. Genao anathan, born from above. At that point, you are instantly sanctified by God in your spirit man. Your spirit man is perfect in the eyes of God and cannot be improved even if you go to heaven. Stays the same. Unfortunately, this is the only thing about the person that's saved. This is sanctified over a period of time. There you go. So you're born again here. Your spirit man is instantly sanctified. Greek word hagiazo means to be set apart for God. But the rest of you, your emotions, your mind, your body, your conscience is not instantly sanctified. It goes through a gradual process of sanctification. What I just taught you there is a major argument among religious people for centuries. I took a look at it and simplified it in 2 seconds. It's a bifurcated process, sanctification. Once you become a born-again Christian, you are not instantly healed of all your emotional pain. You are not instantly physically healed of all your ailments and disabilities. Your mind is not instantly renewed, and you do not think just like Jesus thinks. Okay? The Bible requires you to renew your mind, repent of your sin, and go through this sanctification process. And every Christian is required to do it. If the person will not go through this process, they end up a spiritual loser. So over time, as you study to show yourself approved unto God, as you renew your mind, you start to think like Jesus, you start to act like Jesus, and you have the morality of Jesus. Before you got saved here, your morality sucked. You were a servant of Satan, and you were committing all kinds of sins and breaking all kinds of laws of God. If the Christian will not go through this process, it's hopeless. They're finished. They become something that rhymes with the word clucked. You either go through this process or you're clucked. Period. There are no other options. Why is that? Because human beings and angels all have
free will.
God will not circumvent your free will, and the demons will do anything they can to take it from you. Lying, cheating, stealing, murder, anything. They will do anything to dominate your free will. God will not do a thing. He always waits for volunteers. So, if you're a born-again Christian, good for you. If you want to go relapse on drugs or back to porn, God will go ahead. Once you become a born-again Christian here, you are assigned a guardian angel. They follow you around 24/7. But guardian angels have restrictions based on
free will.
Your free will. Okay? So when I was driving down here, a guardian angel may have saved me from an accident I was unaware of. But if I decide to walk over and slap her, the guardian angel will not manifest in the room and stop me because I'm using my free will to slap her. Hello? Guardian angels have restrictions on things they cannot do. And one of them is you. If you want to go out in the parking lot right now and give God every curse word, no guardian angel will come in here and go, "No, I can't let you do that. That's bad." No, he'll walk out there with you, probably plug his ears. Okay, but if somebody was coming down the street in a car, lost control of it, and suddenly the car veered that way while you were standing there, that's your guardian angel. Is this making any sense? This is the reason I'm going over this again, is because this is how God built human beings, and if you don't understand how they're built, you can't help to fix them. You don't understand them. You're always making mistakes with them. You always get confused with them. But if you understand how they're built, if you understand how all these parts work, emotions, spirituality, genetics, morality, conscience, you can minister them and help fix them. You can understand them. That's what human beings like. They don't want to have anything they don't understand. Humans don't like that. They want to know what's going on. In everything. They go to the doctor, what's wrong with me? They go to a priest, what's wrong? People want to know what the heck is wrong with them. And they're going to come to you, and you need to be able to explain it to them. Because you are a minister of the glorious gospel of Christ. Oh boy. Now I had a little handout here. And I took these scriptures at the top, and then I built the spirit world underneath it. And this is the hierarchy of this kingdom of darkness. And there it is. You've seen it before. And this is what Paul said, principalities and powers and all that stuff. There they are. At the top is Thronos, Colossians, thrones. Somewhere in Satan's kingdoms, there's spiritual thrones somewhere. Kuriotis is lordships. Dominions, it's called in the King James Bible, right? Somewhere in the spirit world, this is there. Where? I don't know. We get a glimpse of it with Daniel. He started praying. The first day he prayed, God heard his prayer, sent an angel to help him. For 21 days, somebody up here blocked that angel from getting to Daniel. Remember that story? Somebody up here, who did that? I don't know. But it was the ruler of Persia, whoever that is. I don't know who that is. But the Bible said the angel got reinforcements, right? And broke through whatever was stopping that here. And then the angel came to Daniel, called him beloved, remember? That's a great story, wasn't it? Yeah, beautiful. And so, spiritual wickedness in heavenly places, number 3. Rulers of the darkness of this world, 4. Principalities, 5. Rulers, 6. And then we come down to our neighborhood, and they're sitting in this room right now looking at me at number 7. There they are. They're right here. Listen to me talk, trying to distract what I'm saying. They're trying to get you to be distracted in your mind right now. Number 7, they're right here. There's probably one there, one here. Some of you brought a bunch of them in. There they are. Daimonian are demons, and daimon are superpowered demons. See that? And there it is. Paul outlined it for us, and he's the only person in history that got this information. Nobody else had it before him. Incredible. And there's the scriptures, to look them up, that Paul gave us at the top. I just put it in an illustrated form. That's all. Because humans like illustration. All right, daimon, these powerful demons, let's transition over here. Ah, there they are. Schizophrenia. Borderline personality disorder. Dissociative identity disorder. Used to be called multiple personality disorder. Bipolar. Yeah. In our society today, these mental illnesses are going like this all across the country. Heading to God only knows where we're going. Yeah. When I was in college back in the 70s, maybe 1% of the population, maybe 1.5%, $40 million Americans have one of these illnesses now. There's only 30 million in America? 340? There's only 340 million people living in this country, and then let's say 20 or 25 million undocumented people live. So there's less than 400 million people living in the United States if you can count all the immigrants and all the citizens. Correct? Mm-hmm. Less than 400. That's unbelievable. So these mental illnesses are sweeping the country. Okay? All these demons here, we kind of illustrated them here for you. Here's these two hands here. And when I work with families or people who are mentally ill, I always give them this little packet. Okay? Got a little illustration for them. And then I took a copy of chapter 21 of Pigs in the Parlor. Okay? They have to have this chapter. Okay? So this is initial homework I give them. Okay? Plus I give them a miracle list for mental illnesses. And that's really all you can do in phase one, you know. But these personality disorders are skyrocketing. For example, you got 5 different subsets of schizophrenia. Under schizophrenia, schizoaffective disorder. A schizophrenic is usually someone who is very intelligent, hears voices. Schizoaffectives tend to be less intelligent, but more emotional. Okay? For example, a guy spoke last night, David, his name. He had schizoaffective. He got healed, schizoaffective disorder. Okay? He didn't have full-blown schizophrenia, where you got a crowd of people talking to you in your head. No, he was good. SA. Okay, and it's kind of like bipolar. Okay? So bipolar is when you have manic mood swings, right? And then bipolar 2 would be you'd have mania, but you'd have much worse mood swings, what clinical depression added. So bipolar 2 is more debilitating because you have the depression component, whereas in 1, they don't normally have that. They're high as a kite, or they're down in the dumps. Then they're high, bipolar, mood swings, mania. But a bipolar 2, they can stay down in the depression. You get more suicides with bipolar 2 than you will with 1. Because the hopelessness is worse there. All right, and let's run through this then. Here's a family. Again, this is generalizations. Okay? I'm generalizing here. Okay? People, you can't do that with people. People are too complex. Generally speaking, okay? Here's a family that has a mom and dad. And again, I'm generalizing. This is morbidly changed now than from when I was a kid. It's when I was in the 50s, once in a while you'd see a parent that didn't have a kid didn't have both parents. You know, it happened occasionally. Now it's routine. Normal. But just play along with me. Let's pretend this is a normal family. See that? There's mom. There's dad. They have a child. Okay, now again, I'm generalizing. These two love the child. Okay, I get it. Doesn't happen often, but I'm just asking you to play along. The parents love the child. Okay? They get divorced. Something bad happens. The child becomes a wayward child. They get involved in all kinds of bad things. They then start to become a demon sponge. They start picking up spirits. Yeah. And whatever a man sows, that shall he also reap. So the higher you go into sin, the more powerful spirits the person absorbs. Okay. So sinning is relative. Yeah. If you ask me a question, I already answered that. That was inappropriate. That was a sharp answer. I shouldn't have done that. Okay. Now, if I go out and find a goat and have intercourse, okay, I've committed a sin here, but tomorrow with a goat, I am sinning off the chart. Are you with me?
Yes.
Okay. Sin is not just sin. There are degrees of sin. When you start getting involved in hardcore sinning, you get hardcore spirits. I planned that. When I need a drink, I just kick it over. See? It's all there. IQ, huge. All right. So if a person is a normal sinner, they are not going to end up with if they are not a normal sinner, uh-oh. Now we're in trouble. A daimon is going to get into the person's brain, and they're going to start developing a severe mental illness. You with me so far? The parents who still love the child, regardless of their sin or their illnesses, normally don't know anything about spiritual warfare and know nothing about what I'm teaching you today. All they know about is their church. They went to church and they got saved. Now they're at a church. And their child had went into hardcore sin and is starting to develop severe signs of mental illness. The parents then, because they love the child, try to help them. Okay? So what they do is they start doctor shopping the child. This psychologist, that one, this psychiatrist, that one, this helper, that helper, so on. Well, during this process, the child gets worse. And then they're on the internet trying to figure out what's wrong with their child. They come across demons. Then they switch over to exorcist shopping. Shop, 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 shop. YouTube, internet, find a name. At the end of that process, the person is sicker. Before that, they try pastoral shopping. This church, that church, this church, that church, this pastor, that pastor, this pastor, that pastor, this priest, that priest. At the end of that process, the person is now sicker than they've ever been. How'd that happen? The parents know nothing about spiritual warfare. All they know is love, and all they're trying to do is save their child. They don't understand that these demons told them to help the child. Spirits always create a problem, then they always provide a solution to fix it. It's a bifurcated system. We gave you the sickness. You kept sinning. But you need to get fixed now, right? Okay, who are we going to use to do that? Well, the demons are going to go to the parents. And they're going to tell them, don't you love your kid? You care about him, right? We got to get him fixed. Why don't you send him to Dr. Quack over here? Or the guy on YouTube who's blowing demons out of a guy out of the trunk of his car. Go call that guy. The demons are telling him to do it. Why? Two reasons. One, they're smarter than we are. Two, they know it's not going to work. Three, the person's going to get worse. Now we come to number four. How am I going to get the parents? Let me think about that. We'll use the child. So then the demons start telling the child, they usually run away to a satanic cult compound, or they're in the state hospital, so they're gone for a while. Then the demons work it out over there, so they're sicker than ever. Then after those people dump the person, they tell that person, go home, because we've got a couple of people who need your attention. Who would they be? Oh, let me think about it for a minute. The people who love them. And they simply analyzed the parents, the guardians, the friends, the relatives. They found out who loved them, who loves this child, who doesn't. Oh, this person does, that one, this one. Boom. Let's go get them. So the demons send the child back to the family, the friends, the relatives, to destroy them. And it works. The parents start going through physical abuse, emotional abuse, mental abuse. Spiritually, they tank. They develop a hard heart. They get angry. They get frustrated. God, why can't this stop? Why won't God answer my prayers? Jeez, I'm sick of this. And the demons are laughing their guts up because they planned the whole thing from day one when the kids started to go here into severe sin. They had the whole plan worked out. Treatment plan, referral sources, boomerang, destroy the parents. Yes, sir.
Well, earlier you said that they start pastoral shopping and church shopping and exorcist shopping, but an exorcist just casts out demons. Deliverance casts out demons. So what's the difference? Why would
Well, that's a great question. Now, He says, send them to exorcists so they cast out demons. These demons here got in from how? Free will. Yeah? Well, if their free will won't allow them to be delivered, no one can cast them out. But the demons want them to try. They find it funny. Why don't you go to this YouTube guy and then that one and this one? They'll deliver your daughter. Oh, really? No, they're going to make the person sicker and wear these people out. You can't cast a demon out of any person who wants to keep it. So if you got cigarette spirits, alcohol, drugs, whatever, we can't get them demons out of there. And if we did, they'd just come right back. The person's free will has to be on board with any form of deliverance, and if it's not, you're going to spend months, years, or decades trying to get that person healed. And the demons know it, so that they just go into, let's wear these folks out. Let's wear the pastors out. Let's wear the counselors out. Let's wear out these exorcists. Then you know what happens? Spiritual abandonment. The exorcists got this theory in their head, here's how you get demons out. Oh, you talk to them, then you send them to heaven, then you bark at them, then you do this and that. Oh, you do, huh? Okay, well, then they try that 4 or 5 times. The exorcist is now worn out. They're pooped. And they finally go, sorry, we can't help. They abandon them. They have to abandon them because they don't know what they're doing. Regular demons, these demons are not regular demons. Okay. See this? Bottom of the pyramid. These demons are different from the sixes, the fives, the fours, the threes. See, they're all different. These demons here are not regular demons. Fear, lust, depression, anxiety. We cast them out all the time. You know why? Because someone who's not mentally ill comes to see us and they don't want them. And they're willing to repent and they're willing to change. So the demons come out. Right? They're easy to get out. These people here don't do that. They want to keep their demons. Huh? In that case, then I have to go to the people who love them and tell them, run for your lives. Save yourself. You've been set up for termination. The devil's going to use the sick daughter, the sick son, the whoever, to destroy you. And they're going to get away with it because you love them. That's the hook. It's all set up. It's all a plan. 97% of these schizophrenics are nonviolent. 3% of them, they're on the news. They go into a movie theater. That 3% is growing. Mass murderers. Yeah.
How is it that this group wants to keep their demons? Like what? How? Why?
Well, some people, for example, a lust demon. Lust demons are given to people as a benefit from Satan. And they use lust demons to get themselves out of anxiety and pain. So when you're high, drunk, or whatever, for that brief period of time, you're not in pain. And so that benefit of drugs and alcohol and other things is something some people don't want to give up because it's a natural refuge and they don't hate it. So I can't get a lust demon out of that person because they want to keep it. Yes, sir.
Can a Christian be sometimes schizoaffective in behavior and at other times walk in the spirit?
Yeah, of course. What happens is, can a schizoaffective Christian act like a psycho? Sure. The demons are not in your spirit, man, where the Holy Ghost is in a born-again Christian. They're in your brain. And he's modifying the person's behavior, thoughts, attitudes. So at some point, the Holy Spirit may be affecting the person. And the other times, the demon takes over the brain. Yeah. So without a mentally ill patient, same thing's true. A lust demon would be in your body affecting your sex drive, and then your Holy Spirit would be here trying to hold it down. So you'd have this inner conflict. Yeah. Sir?
Your book, Plain of Spirits, I've read many times, but it's an amazing book you did on this. You talked about on these spirits right there in that book. I've never heard it before. You talked about coward spirits. It's coward spirits that cause people with those spirits not to ask for help.
Well, what he's talking about is Paul said to Timothy, God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power and love. Yeah, that was mistranslated. Dalia is the Greek word for cowardice. So, fear spirits and cowardice spirits are always partners. They work together. And the fear spirit is the one that gives the person these fright. And the coward spirit's the one that comes back and tells them, hey, you can't really go for help. You know, it's going to be hard. It's embarrassing. You're shy. You know, stop. Okay. And they work with normal people, non-mentally ill people. Everybody has them. Coward demons help you not fight because it causes anxiety. I got to make changes. Oh, what if I do this, then I'll have to do, oh, I don't know. Gosh, that's a coward demon. Yeah, these people have virtually the same spirits as a regular person. I mean, these are on steroids. Mentally ill people are steroid demons, powerhouses. Why? They got into severe sin, witchcraft, sorcery, bestiality, murder, name it. Okay. When you started out on porn over here, you weren't an addict. You didn't become an addict until the lust demons got in. Now they've taken over. Now you can't stop. You can't stop it. See the difference? Sinning turns into OCD, an obsessive compulsive disorder of sin. See the difference? If a person isn't addicted to something, they can stop anything. If they choose to, with their free will, they can stop it. If they're an addict, they cannot just stop. They got too many demons in.
So could it come in through like generational, like those demons, can they come in?
Well, of course, yeah. Your genetics are the product of your family tree, all your genetics. So you're related to your great, 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 whatever. And spiritually, same thing. Demons can get in up here. Mason demons are really popular. In the 50s, huge. Masonry, right down the tree. Witchcraft, down.
Herschel Walker, was that BPD?
No. Herschel Walker is one of the greatest athletes in the history of the United States. You know who he is? The guy's a freak. He went through, I mean, literally horrific child abuse. Horrific child abuse. Every single day, he got the crap beat out of him at school. Bullied off the rack as a kid. Beat up, cursed from here to here. They all got in, multiple personalities. Why'd they do that? As a benefit to the person. Look, hey, here's you and your life sucks, right? Yeah, I'll tell you what. Well, you can become a different person. Right? So about 4 years ago, three, whenever it was, he was running for some political office. What was that? Do you remember?
Congress.
What office was he running to? Congress?
I think so.
Yeah. From Alabama, right? Remember that? Yeah. I saw that on the news. As I told you before, I turned to my wife. I said, oh my God. Herschel Walker's running for political office. He is going to get destroyed. How do you know that, Brother Mike? Are you a genius? Well, that's obvious, but no. These people leave a trail of degrading insanity behind them. What was it? I didn't know. I only knew it was there. It wasn't 2 weeks it started. They started digging up stuff on Herschel Walker from this relationship, this woman, that abortion, this. I mean, they dug this guy up. Now they found the right combination of medications, so now he's relatively stable. Okay, but I knew that back then he was not stable. And they were going to hunt him down, and they did. Nobody with these illnesses can run for political office, with several exceptions, which I will not name now so I don't get deplatformed, but you know their names. These are steroid spirits. These are your normal demons. Okay? We run into these all the time. All right. Click. I was at a church in 2005. I went down to the altar, and there was a kid standing there, and the Holy Ghost spoke to me and said, mentor that kid. I didn't think anything of it. I met him, said hi. All right, I'll meet you at Burger King tomorrow. Talk to you then. Met him at Burger King. I don't normally question everything God does, but yeah, that one got me. Full-blown paranoid schizophrenia. Full-blown paranoid schizophrenia. Right? There's five subsets of schizophrenia. There they are, listening for you. He had paranoid schizophrenia. He'd been in 3 mental institutions. He was taking 8 medications a day. And while we're sitting at Burger King, we're eating lunch there, he says to me, "They're talking about me in the back." I didn't even make it through my Whopper. And it started. The mentoring. He's talking about me. That guy. I get up, I go, "Okay, listen, Nick, there's nobody talking about you in the back, okay? The guy talking about you is in here." Yeah, finished my Whopper. And then the next 5 years, you wouldn't believe what I went through with that kid. You wouldn't have believed, and you wouldn't believe how many victories that kid had. But he had something most of these people don't have. What is that? A burning desire for God. And because his free will was on board, in about 1.5 years, he was completely delivered of schizophrenia.
Wow.
It was all completely gone. It took 3 years to get the rest of the demons out of him. Yeah. But how do you get that way? I just told you. Heavy duty drugs, heavy duty sexual sin. He would pick gals up on the internet, go over to their house for sex, boom, 3-4 times a week, different gals. Didn't matter what their age were, unbelievable. Drugs and alcohol, huge. Partying, adultery, spectacular. Then he ended up in a satanic cult. And they kicked him out. Why? He was too sick to be in a satanic cult. But he wasn't too sick for Brother Mike. Okay? Guy spoke last night. Schizoaffective. I got on the sheet there. Same thing. Free will. He was desperate for God. The Holy Ghost can heal anything in the book for a person who's desperate for God. That's his specialty. See all these demons on here, on this list? He kicks their butts. He drop kicks them. For a person who's desperate for God. A person who is not desperate for God. Here's why they call me lucky. I have to go to the parents, the loved ones, the wife, the spouse, and tell them they can't be delivered. Free will is not there. Well, what do we do now, Brother Mike? Well, we have to wait for God to intervene. How does he do that? Trauma. Something really bad has to happen to the person to reset their mind. Could be anything. Near-death experience, car wreck, cancer, mugging, whatever it is. Could be anything. They have to reset. And then you have to jump in at that moment to save them. Okay? This kid that I met had been kicked out of the satanic cult. He was in the Tony Alamo cult from Arkansas. You ever heard of Tony? He's dead now. They kicked him out because he had schizophrenia. They couldn't control him. Yeah? They dumped him off at the Los Angeles airport. Just dumped him out in the street. And the demons told him, "Hey, they've sent you on a missionary trip. You're talking to him in his head. You're on a mission. It's a mission field. And to get their attention, you know what you need to do? Take off your clothes. He takes his clothes off and starts preaching to L.A. Have you ever been to the L.A. airport? There are so many people there, you can't believe it. They carted him off to what? Another mental institution. Okay? So then he ended up in Scottsdale. I ran into him at church that night. Boom, the rest was history. But I'm trying to explain to you that these spirits are much stronger than normal demons. And if the person's free will is not with us, we can't get them out. If they don't care, we can't care enough to get them to repent. And trust me, everybody does. Please do it. I'm begging you. Stop that. Change that. You can do better. I'll help you. God loves you. And they go through a series of encouragements, a series of instructions, all designed by demons. They want you to do it. Why? To wear you out. So they use the kid, they come back, divorce. They use the kid, come back, beatings, house on fire, cops called, back to jail. I mean, it's like, you can't even believe it. It's a nightmare. All designed, planned out to get the loved ones. The demons want the people that love them. And they're coming for them. Soul wound healing does not work with these kind of patients without all the other ministries involved. Soul wound healing alone doesn't work. So you can send them to soul wound healers, altar talkers. What are you doing in there, demon? I got in when he smoked pot in fourth grade. Oh, you did, huh? You gonna come out of there? No, I'm not coming out. Well, are you gonna go to the courts of heaven and get your butt kicked? Yes, okay, I'll come out. Stop. Stop it. They're going to get sicker doing that. Sicker. Yeah. People who have these illnesses usually are intelligent people. They're usually smart intellectually. They're bright. A lot of them are well educated. You know? But these demons are so smart. They are textbook manipulators. Oh, they're so brilliant. They'll try to wedge their way into your family, into a relationship. They'll put on a front. They appear to be improving. They're getting better. Yeah, boom, then a disaster hits. Designed to do one thing, chop the people who care down. So, while they're YouTubing, now they're looking for an exorcist. Oh, and guess whose name pops up? Yes, thank you. Oh, I'm here for you. This is why they call me lucky. I have to sit down with whoever I'm working with and tell them the truth, which no one else did. I got to tell them, hey, if this person's not going to cooperate, we've got to have some kind of trauma to snap it. They got to be broken. Then they'll listen. That kid I had at the Dream Center, he'd just been thrown out of a cult. He just got out of another mental illness. The kid was broken. He was desperate for God. He couldn't take it anymore. And that's the best spot to be in. For anybody, whether you're mentally ill or not, that's the best spot to be in life. But you can see the bifurcated problem here. People that are intelligent are usually spiritually weak. They may have a huge knowledge of Scripture, but spiritually can't pray their way out of a wet paper bag. So you got the IQ working against you, that's usually high. Then you got the past sinning of severe sinning, not just regular sinning. Once you start severely sinning, monsters come in. Just like King Saul. He started out prophesying, ended up committing suicide. After he went to a witch. After he was prophesying with the prophets, he went from here to hell. And trust me, any of these illnesses are pure hell. Borderline patients are far more violent than schizophrenics. I knew a guy personally who two of his ex-wives had BPD. And he'd been beaten up several times by both of them. The frightening thing about women who have BPD, and most of them are women, is that they are very emotional. They get very excited about good things. They're very passionate sexually. They're great lovers. And the demons use that skill to draw in the fly into the net. He had two of them. Moral of that story? I'm not going to say we're taping this, but sex is great, but it's not that important to get beat up over with the cops at your house and your living room on fire. Okay, the sex isn't that good. You know, put it in perspective. Yeah, so if you've got this, NPD, narcissistic personality disorder, just as bad on another area. Have you ever been married or known a narcissist? If you have, yeah, you started drinking again. They respond to nothing. They are chronic manipulators. They have very high IQs, and they will just manipulate the stuffing out of you, and they'll fake it like they're getting better, and it is awful, and it goes on for years. I've never had a narcissistic patient delivered. They're that hard to get out because they love religion. And I tell them, quote the Bible to them, they quote me another verse. You know, it's awful. Absolutely awful. I'm not trying to discourage you, but I'm trying to warn you, here and all deliverance ministries and churches are going to be flooded with these people. And I get calls every week from somebody who said, hey, my pastor told me to come over and see you. Translation, they're so jacked up the church can't handle them, so they send them over to Brother Mike. So they use us as a dumping ground. And what we're trying to do is reverse it on them and make this a Holy Ghost deliverance center, not a dumping ground. But you cannot help people if you don't tell them the truth. Yeah. So now it's 6-something%, 7% of their violent, these higher. If nothing's going to change here, I got to get the loved ones to get on the life raft and save themselves before they get either beat up or maimed or whatever. Somebody gets shot, Okay, if nothing's going to go right, I got to get them to protect themselves. You got to get them to make some kind of a lifestyle change if you sense danger is around the corner. Okay, just skip the deliverance and go for the safety. Okay? We can come back to the other later. Because the demons want you just to look, you got to be an eternal helper for this person. That's what they want. King Saul probably developed NPD. We know he had schizophrenia because the demons were talking to him. He was so sick it was unreal. And he ended up dead. Okay, which is what happened to most of them. Most of them end up dead. We have, I don't know, me and all the other counselors here, maybe a dozen people we're working with right now that are just chronic. They do well, then they fall. They do well, then they fall. Then they do well, then they fall. But they're falling a little less, and they're doing a little better. And so we use our patience to keep helping them. If they're still improving a little bit, I stay with them. If they're falling a little bit less, I'll stay with them. If it's nothing's working and they're not going to change, I dump them. Because you can't waste all your time on this one who's a total loser when you've got somebody else coming in who will change and will get healed. You put your energy there. Okay? For example, some guy with most of these comes running to Wigglesworth. The guy was, you remember the story in his book, the guy was an executioner. And so the state would, somebody in the state or the country of England, whatever it was, they would kill these criminals, and he was the guy managing the kill floor, so to speak. And he was living in terrible sin, so these demons would leave these dead bodies and jump into him. Okay, and then he became criminally insane. They fired him. But like the maniac of Gadara, this guy and the maniac of Gadara had some of their real person left. And that real person, that smidgen of their real humanity, was desperate for God. There was something left. They weren't 100% gone. And they ran to Jesus. He ran to Wigglesworth. None of the other mentally ill people got healed. Correct? It was just them. Why?
Well,
yeah. God has free will, but he already told us what it was. He says, this is my body broken for you. Come unto me, all you labor. I already know what God's will is. It's to heal all these people. I'm not focusing on God's will. You know, I never get up. Father, can you come down here and sit here? Let's do some counseling now. I want you to do some reflection here, and I need you to change. No, I don't do that. Everything's fine on God's end. The problem isn't God's end. God's on my end and the person's end. God's will is already yes. All the promises of God in Christ are?
Yes.
Right. I don't need to worry about God's will anymore. That's not even on the table. I got it. Bang, it's in the bag. This person, that's a total different story. I need to find out what their free will is. And if it's desperate for God, they're going to get healed, period. But if the person doesn't care, you can't make people care. You can't make them change. I try to, you know, in sometimes I told you before, you know, I'll yell at them. I'll get their face. You know, I'll try, you know, that type of technique once in a while if I think I have an opening. Try and blast them. But you cannot force someone to change. And God won't force them. I never pray and ask, Lord, take over this person's free will, drag them down the street, draw and quarter them, bring them back. I never do that. Because I know he's not going to do it. There's no point in me wasting prayers on stuff I'm going to get a no on. Correct? Yeah. I read a book on Finnis Jennings Dake one time. Probably never heard of him anyway. After I'd done that book, I went to the Lord and I prayed, Dear Jesus, give me that mind. Give me that. I want to quote every verse in the Bible. Okay, I stopped praying that prayer. Free will. It's so bad. And it's so good. I have loved ones that are not saved. I would give anything to have this supernatural power of free will control. You will love the Lord and repent of all your sin. Are you doing it?
I am.
Yes. You see, I got it now. Did you see the power? But we don't have those skills. Nobody does. You can't force anybody. Anybody who's a parent knows what I'm talking about, for crying out loud. If you had kids, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You can't force people to do anything. But God can manipulate the thing to make you want to do it. And that's why I said earlier that people that are super sick have these terrible demons can be brought to a trauma period where it's, oh my God, I need help, so to speak.
It was
Mikey.
You had a guy that he had bipolar, right, that you prayed for in the trailer a long time. Was that early in your ministry?
Before I got delivered.
That was before you got delivered?
Yeah, it's unbelievable.
Wow.
Yeah, it was there. Yeah, it was a sovereign act of mercy.
Before you knew anything about mind renewal and all that stuff.
Yeah. Well, I knew about mind renewal from my church background. Yeah. But I started off on the radio in 2002. And I was over at KPXQ down here. And I used to have a service that I made up called Set Free Saturdays. See? And as soon as I come up with that, everybody said, man, this guy's Rhodes Scholar. And I would go out to their homes on Saturdays and pray for them. Call in. I'll come out to your house. And I did. I used to go out on Saturdays. And boy, that was that a learning experience. It was great. And I hadn't been delivered from demons yet. I didn't know I had them. I go out to Apache Junction in a rat hole trailer. I mean, this thing is trash. I sit down in the living room. He's got a card table there, two busted up chairs. I'm sitting there. I do my clinical interview. And I'm praying to myself, Lord, this guy's got bipolar. This sounds exactly like these symptoms. You know, I knew about that because I came out of psychology, left that and went into this. I don't know what to do with this guy, and I know bipolar is not curable, so I don't know what to do. So I thought to myself, I'll just take a shot at this. So I asked him if I could pray for him. Yeah. I get up, I walk over, and I put my hands on his head, like a circle around his skull. Like that, he was sitting at the card table there. And I don't even know what I was praying. I'm sure it was incredible. But it was fumbling through a prayer. And this guy's head starts to go tuning fork on me. My eyes got saucered. And he jumps. I step back. I call on Elizabeth. I look down at his eyes. They're clear as a bell, pointing ahead. I say, I couldn't believe it. I asked him how he was. He said, I feel fine. Well, so what about your mind, your brain? What are you thinking? I don't know. It's peaceful in there. I feel lighter, he said. Weird. So I go, oh, okay, well, I think God answered your prayers. Scooped up my Bible and bolted out the door. Couldn't wait to get out of there. Called him a couple weeks later. He's fine. So I think it was God planting a seed here that, hey, you know, you're going to need to use this later. I didn't know what was going on. You know, I still don't. I still don't have a bunch of a clue of it. Yeah. Yeah, it's been an insane journey. It really has. It's been unbelievable. But the victories along the way and seeing all these people get healed, that kept me going. A lot of the stuff was bad. I just pushed that aside and kept moving forward. That was the kind of personality I had. So that came in handy. Yes, ma'am.
It seems like a lot of times it's by faith that stepping into things. It's not necessarily like having to, like, you didn't actually, like, say, come out of him and cast a demon out. Mm-hmm. It's God's grace and mercy that can heal and deliver.
Sure.
Instantly. It's a miracle.
Right.
It.
Yeah.
Because if we step by faith and believe that, because sometimes we don't even know, is it a curse, is it a demon, is it a sickness, but we stand there and we believe, as the Lord says, you know, tell that mountain to move, you have the small faith as a mustard seed, so we don't know what God is going to do. We can't put him in a box. He can just perform anything as he wants right there and then.
Yeah, that's true, but in practicality, in practicality, you're talking about this amount. It's rare. Okay. This part here is repent, change, learn, study, believe. There is a small section, for example, the guy at the pool. God just walked up to him sovereignly to heal the guy and then have him tell the rest of them, and then that whole thing started. Yeah. So that happened to me here, but it doesn't happen like that very often at all. Now the guardian angel stuff that I said earlier, that happens all the time. Every one of you ought to be dead right now. You have no idea how many times you were saved from an accident, from falling, from something. Anything that you were blocked. It's amazing. But you are not saved from anything that your free will wanted to do that God disapproved of. Now, you screwed yourself. They won't stop it. They will not stop it. So a lot of drug addicts come here and they get delivered. Those are lust demons. But none of them are SMIs, right? They're just alcoholics, they're just drug addicts. They're just porn addicts or whatever. A lot of people come here and get healed of anxiety disorders, depression, routine. They're not SMIs, though. They're regular people that have anxiety and depression and, you know, tough stuff. See them healed all the time. And occasionally we see these healed, if we can get them to go with the program. And I start them out with this program. Here, I give them this chapter, I give them this handout, I give them the miracle list, start. And then you monitor the person, right? You gave them one step to do, did you do it? No, I haven't done it yet. Oh, red flag, now we're in trouble. Okay, let's try it again, so I give them another chance. Try that. Did you do that? No, I didn't write it down. Oops, another red flag. Click. There's a second one. You know, and you kind of get to know the person as you go through it, whether they really want to be healed or not. And you can tell in their behavior. A person that really wants to be healed acts a certain way. Correct? You can spot their behavior. They listen, they learn, they obey. See, if they don't want to do that, you stay with them for a while, and if they're not changing, cut. You got to dump them. Yeah?
Jesus said, you know, his followers would cast out demons. Is there a deliverance anointing that makes that work?
Is there a deliverance anointing?
That makes, you know, the manifestation. Something
sure.
Makes that demon manifest to come out. Is that a deliverance anointing that makes that work?
There's no specific deliverance anointing in the Bible. Every Christian has it. Every you have it. You have healing anointing, you have deliverance anointing, you have that. The problem is, you have to use your free will to develop your anointing. Okay? So when you're first saved, every man is dealt a measure of faith. So we all get the same measure when we start. But Wigglesworth took his measure from here to there, right? And King Saul took his anointing from here to there, based on
free will.
Free will. Okay. So, if you are a born again Christian, so that means the Holy Spirit's in there. All your gifts are there. All your fruit is there. But the faucet is run here. So you determine where your anointing goes, how much Holy Ghost fruit you have, and how successful your ministry is. But you already have the anointing to do it, because the Holy Spirit has everything, lacking nothing, and you have Him. And it's all up to you. Anyone can be healed and delivered depending on their free will. So I try my best to get that free will jump started. Sometimes I kick them in the fanny. Sometimes I yell at them. Sometimes I hug them. Sometimes I kiss them. I do everything for that person to see if I can jump start faith, fury. People who have these demons, their free will's given up. So I got to reboot their free will. Hey, listen, if you don't turn your life over to God and you don't stop playing around here, you're going to die. You're going to be an institution, and your parents, you won't even know your parents' names. That's where you're headed. you're going to be gone. So now in our society, they don't have enough beds for these people now. There's too many of them. So now they're all on court-ordered medication. You're on probation. You show up once a week. Boom. That will keep your brain from destroying your neighborhood. Now what happens? The demons go, "You're healed." They back off the person, "I'm feeling better." And then they stop taking meds. And then they're in a Circle K, climbing the walls. Routine, happens all the time. Because in the secular world, no one understands anything about demons. No one knows anything that I'm teaching. Everything I'm teaching here is heresy to them. They think I'm a psycho. I'm a witch doctor. I'm a medieval practitioner who should be locked up. I see a lot of you nodding. That's disappointing. These things are so smart.
Meds ever interfere with the free will or the hunger for God?
The meds. Glad you mentioned that. Now, we never tell anybody to get off their meds because we could get sued. And it's not our place. I'm not a doctor. If you can get the right combination of medications, sometimes that will slow the person's mind down enough to get them to listen to you enough to receive some truth. If they bungle the medication, the side effects are so bad, the patient picks up more demons and they get worse. It's a juggling act. So, if somebody comes here like this and they start making progress, which most of them do, the demons always tell them, "Boy, you're feeling great now. You're doing well. You don't need any meds." And they go cold turkey. Now we have a spike of insanity. And now we got the body in on it because the body's now used to taking these high-powered drugs. And it explodes. So I never tell them to stop taking meds. And you don't do it either. You can cut down on your meds. As we get more demons out, your meds can go down, but you got to supervise it under your doctor and go down gradually. If you cold turkey them, the body then explodes. Now we got egg on our face. So if the combination is right, it'll allow the person's mind to slow down enough to receive some truth from you. If it's off, they'll get worse. They won't be able to listen to a thing you're saying. The demons like the drugs because the people prescribing them don't understand spirits. And sometimes they turn them into zombies. And once they turn into zombies, they can't retain anything. Even basic, simple stuff. The Lord Jesus, He truly loves you. Just kind of falls out. I've called doctor's offices in the past, said, "Hey, I'm having these side effects. Can we substitute something similar to this? Swap that." And they'll do it. Because they know you're helping them. "Hey, I'm a counselor. I'm so-and-so's counselor. We got these side effects, kooking out here, insomnia, irritability, whatever it is." I said, "Can we switch this one for that one?" And they'll do it, you know, because they want the person, they don't want the person to come in their office anymore, so they figure they're in your office, they're doing better, so they'll switch meds. Yeah, so medication is an asset or it's a liability. But we never tell them to stop taking them, go cold turkey. We always say, if I know the demons are coming out, I see progress, then I say, "Hey, we can taper off the meds under a doctor's supervision, and that will keep you from getting sued and hurting the patient." Right? That guy that just asked me that question, what's your name?
John.
John is his name. He has a real high IQ. He picked up everything I said just like that. Didn't you? He's trying to be humble. Yeah.
Ones that are not on meds, like on the streets and stuff, you'd recommend trying to get them maybe on meds so they can become more coherent and hear what you're saying? Is that?
Yeah, if you can, yeah. If they can't, if you're not getting any truth in at all, yeah. Is what you're saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure, why not? You know, it's risky because the guy given the meds doesn't understand what you're trying to do spiritually. They don't believe in any of that stuff. It's a tough juggling act, balancing act, difficult. But again, free will break through all of it. The meds, the demons, the physical problems, the addiction, we can win. The Holy Ghost around, you can win. Okay, so you're working with somebody on this list. They're not doing well. So I'll just walk them through second grade. I was in fifth grade one time at my grade school, Whittier Grade School in Kansas. And that Saturday they were having a fun fair or something going on at the grade school. I was in fifth grade, so I went over and one room they were having a cakewalk. And I thought, well, I'll try that. I got into it, I walked, went around, called the numbers out. Boop, long story short, I won. I got a cake. I'd never won anything in my life. That was the last time I ever won anything. Fourth grade, fifth grade. I took the cake home to my mother. I was so proud. I command you to think straight. I give her the cake. I was so happy. I gave my mother a cake. I felt like $1 million. Yeah. This whole thing is risky. You know, you're going to go and they'll call the number and it's not your number. And then you got to go to the next one and it's not your number. And you got to keep going until you get the cake. Yeah. You have a question?
Oh.
Sometimes people give me obscene gestures because they don't like what I'm saying. So, and I mistake it for a question. You are going to think straight from now. No one will ever sit there anymore. So, if you get involved in this, which you're going to, if you're going to be in the ministry, there's no way to get out of it. We're getting referrals up the yin yang, whatever that means. That's Chinese. What it means is it's a lot, and they're increasing all the time. I'm getting calls from people all over the country. What do we do? And almost all of them have been to other deliverance people. Almost all of them. And by the time I get them, they're so mad, so exhausted, and so frustrated that before I even meet them, they don't like me. They're just trying to save someone they love, is what it amounts to. And they don't know how to do it. And they have no spiritual background to do it. Most of these loved ones are weak Christians, don't know anything about spiritual warfare. They just want God to give them a light switch fix. Click! It's over. Okay, go back to normal life, back to college, back. It doesn't work like that with these kinds of demons. It doesn't work like that. They're too smart for that. You're dealing with a superior intellect. See that? Now, some of these demons of seven, daimonion, those, that's the normal word for demon. Some of them are not very bright. The daimon, no, they're very intelligent. The other demons, lust demons, fear demons, a lot of them are not very smart. Sometimes when you're doing deliverance, they'll say something stupid that hurt themselves. I've had that happen several times. The demon will bark something out that I thought, man, that idiot should have, that was information I can use. They should have shut up. Okay, now I know I'm not dealing with a superpowered demon. I'm dealing with a dummy. And then there's other demons that, you know, they don't know you, so they figure you're an idiot. So they make up a story like, I am Legion. Oh, you're Legion. Okay, just come on out. Let's go. Actually, the Legion one. That's the fourth time this week I got a Legion. Oh, no. I had one of them yell at me, I'm Satan. I'm not Camille. Oh, you're Satan. He knew I was on to him when I started laughing. Some of them are not super intelligent, but these know we're at another level here of intellect, far greater than yours. You're out of your league. Lust demons are usually not very intelligent. They're just primal urges. Here, look at that, and go get her. Masturbate. Blech. You know, that doesn't take a huge amount of intellect. But these schizophrenia demons, particularly they got religious demons, oh my gosh. They're quoting the Bible to you. They're quoting Islam to you. They got the Quran. They got an answer for everything you say. It's amazing how smart they are. And so you can see the dangers of witchcraft and drugs and alcohol. You can see the dangers because you can make the leap over here and they're going to get infected. I had a guy come in recently who, when he was young, had sex with some farm animals. And he was just spiritually dead. Had been for decades. That thing got in and shut him. He just shut this thing down. Click. So what do you got to do with them? Well, let's say you're working with somebody like that, this, and they're not doing well. So I just go third grade on them. Okay? Now here's how I want you to pray, Bob. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. No, Bob. Now that's not the kind of prayer I'm talking about. Did you hear the intensity in my voice? Bob. Lord Jesus. Come on. God, forgive me. Bob. And then I literally take them like a second grader and teach them a changed behavior. See, now you're praying like that. That's not going to work. You've already prayed like that 500 times. Did it work? No, it did not. Okay? What's the definition of insanity? Everybody knows it. We can't keep doing the same thing over and over and seeing a failure expecting something to change. Hello? Now, come on, Bob. Were you involved in witchcraft? Oh, my God, where's your godly sorrow? That's the worst thing you can get involved in. You destroyed yourself when you got involved in witchcraft. Come on now. I'll try that. What am I trying to do? I'm trying to boost their free will just a bit. Try to just kind of knock it up a bit. You know, so maybe they would trigger and go for God. Right? That farm animal guy, it worked. I took him to the sanctuary. I paraded him around for about a half hour. Taught him, yelled at him, everything. And he made improvements. He kind of got it. Oh, yeah, this is what I kind of need to do. I need to step my game up. I need to push it. Dear Lord Jesus, I need to be healed. Stop! You prayed that prayer 5,000 times, it doesn't work. Let's push this thing. Do you want to be healed? Yeah. Well, Bob, now that, yeah. See, now that yeah is bothering me. That didn't sound like you wanted to be healed. See, I've been a counselor for 40 years. I've heard yeahs before. I think I'm familiar with it. Yeah. Okay, you don't have it. You don't have a miracle. Yeah, there. You got a yeah there. Come on, do it like this, Bob. Yes, in Jesus' name. Try it, Bob. Bob, try, bend over. Boom. Try it again. I do whatever I have to do to try and get the kid to jump start, to go for God. I know this sounds weird. None of this is sounds normal. What do you, you're here, aren't you? Okay. Then the abnormal is normal. You get the person to push it. See? Kind of like coaching, in a way, without all the cursing and abuse. I mean, coaches do it. Right? Lombardi did it. He did it. It worked for him. Why am I doing it? Doing that? Love. I'm not doing that because, A, I don't have anything else to do. I'm bored. No, I'm trying to save this person's life. And going to somebody on YouTube is not gonna, it's not gonna work. Not with these kind of demons. Okay, last strategy then. Go to the back, go to the parents, and see if you can get them delivered. And then they will jump in and help you work on the daughter or the son who's really jacked up. So now you've got a threesome fighting for where two or three are gathered in my name. There am I in the midst. Now you've got a group of warriors. But if the parents don't give a rat's fanny about God and they don't, they won't repent, they won't do the miracle list, what chance have I got here? It's just more problems, more adversity, more blockages, more disappointments. Okay? Because no one will love them more than the spouse or the parents. Right, or the kids, whoever the loved ones are. They love them more than anybody else. So if you can get them delivered, they will step in and fight. And that makes your job just much easier. So much easier. Because God's people always perish because they have a lack of... Yeah, and this is what I'm trying to give you as knowledge. Like I said, I put all this in my book on mental illness and Christians. Unfortunately, the bookstore is indisposed right now. But like the rest of the building, this is what is going on in the spirit world. Here's what it looks like. Here's a little packet I give them. Okay? So if you got counselors, if you got somebody... come get a copy of this. I'll give you a copy, a little packet I give them. SMIs, the seriously mentally ill. Because statistically, it's climbing like crazy in the United States. There's so many sick people out there now. It's people are stunned. Okay. How'd that go? All right. Okay. Let's pray then. Father God, I did the best I could today, and if the Holy Ghost anoints, then something great will happen. If it's just me here, nothing good is ever going to happen. Brother Mike can't do anything. So I am looking to the Lord Jesus, the author and the finisher of my faith. I'm looking to nobody else, not one other soul. And I know that every person that wants to be healed and has turned their free will over to you can get healed today, right now, in the name of Jesus. Okay, amen. If you need prayer, come down here to the front. My ministry team's here. My ministry team's here. And you can get amazing touch from God right here. Right here. Anybody need to be prayed over right here? Right here. Thank you, Jesus. You're going in my office. You're going in my office.
That's fine.
Not right now.
Right now.
Thank you, Jesus. Anybody else need a touch from God? Okay. And what do you need, huh?
My neck is still hurting.
Your neck is hurting. Okay, now.
I don't know.
When did that happen?
Since I was younger and then off and on, it starts getting stiff. This is the longest.
Oh. Now, did you hear that?
I don't know.
She says her neck is hurting and stiff, and it started when she was young. So that means it's usually tied into something emotional.
They said my spine is out of alignment too.
Oh, that's from what?
My x-rays are showing it's out of alignment.
And at what age?
Penis, they called it the other day.
Oh, at what age?
Oh, she just told me this a few weeks ago.
When did you start having the condition though?
From whiplash, car accidents. I don't know.
How many years was it?
18 years old.
Oh, 18. Okay, so there's two long-term problems there. The first one's the neck. Okay. Now, you're going to repent today, right? You're going to fight today? Yeah, I know you are. What's wrong with you?
Still working on my chest.
What's the block?
Every time, whenever I go to bed, I sleep, it gets congested.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It's been going on for a long time.
How many years?
17.
17. And then just before that, he got in how?
I don't know.
He got this thing is in his chest. He got it 17 years ago. Okay? Gemma, what's wrong with you, sweetheart?
What happened? Sugar cravings or
diabetes. Yeah. Okay, now she's got diabetes, so that's a soul issue, right?
Okay.
Right here. That's this thing here. And did you used to hate yourself when you were young?
Yes.
Did you used to hate your body? Okay, that triggered the diabetes. That's a soul issue. Okay, you got to repent of that. You got to repent of that, okay? You going to do that? Hey, what's wrong with you, sir?
I think it was Thursday when praying for me, something came up the back of my neck.
Oh, yeah. You're the Kundalini guy.
Is that what it is?
Yeah. Did you ever have somebody put their hands on you in a church service and pray over you? When was that? When did that thing start?
What then?
That thing that moved. Or did you even know it was in there?
No.
Oh, okay. Okay, that means you have a nice anointing. Because that thing just came right up. So that's a good sign. Do you speak in tongues?
Yeah.
Okay, let's try it. Go ahead. Under emotion. Louder. Okay, stop. Now. Your gift of tongues is blocked. Okay, so let's unblock it. The Greek word for tongues is glossa. And it's a language, like every other language, is made out of syllables. Like California, four syllables. Glossa is the same thing. Remo Shavasa. And that was five syllables. Yeah? You notice how your syllables are running together? You notice that? Okay, good. That's the same as stuttering in English. Okay? So, now let's just try it again. You repeat after me. Moya Shaba. Kemo Shatia. Vekoba. You see how easy you repeated that?
Yeah.
Okay, now you add some of your language syllables, only syllables, not running together, blah, 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 syllables, like I was. I was using short syllables.
Yeah.
There he goes. He's doing it right there.
So hold on. So you said before, but I would the
don't do that. That's the that much better. Much better. They're using short syllables.
Right.
See that?
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, if you develop that, we can get him out of there. Okay? Go ahead. Make sure he speaks in tongues.
Infirmities.
Go. Go. Come out of there. You get out of that body right now. Hurry up. Come out of that body right now. Hurry up. You get out of there. Come on, everybody,
right now.
Come out. There I go. You get out of there. You rotten devil, get out of there. Come out of the woman of God.
Come out right now.